in this module, we are going to graduate from looking at just vacuum. We're going to make the first steps to look at situations where there are realistic materials, okay? And also boundary conditions. How will we impose boundary conditions, right? So we're building the FDTD up in complexity step by step. So far, in vacuum, we looked at the main things. How do you set up the computational cell? How do you look at stability? How do you look at convergence and accuracy? All of those things, right? Now let's look at materials. Okay, so we'll start with dielectric materials. Okay, now your Maxwell's equations said, for example, curl of H, right? And supposing I have a dielectric material, so what is the constitutive relation I used? How would I introduce the permittivity of the object in here? Epsilon needs to come in, right? So what I would do is put D is equal to epsilon E. Okay. Now one of the main things that I want to sort of challenge in this section is our use of this equation. So what we'll find out today is that our use of this equation is actually been very, very flawed throughout. So we'll try to put this on a proper footing now. Okay. So for now, let's just assume that this equation is correct. So then what would happen is that you would simply have this equation would become epsilon E dot is equal to curl of H, correct? And that's how we deal with in any E cell, I assign the permittivity to be epsilon 1, epsilon 2, whatever, right? So this is then fixed appropriately okay. Yes, okay, so what supposing this is your computational domain, right? So what our E cell is going to fracture this whole thing into a square grid. That's how we do it. And now this over here, this has some epsilon 1. Okay, so first of all, what I do is I do a piecewise constant approximation of epsilon. So wherever there is a square grid, I assume the epsilon is constant over there. So this is some epsilon 1, this is some epsilon 2, and so on, right? So on this grid, once I fix the values of epsilon, then I use these update equations with the appropriate value of epsilon or mu, right? I will also replace B is equal to mu H and put those values of mu, right? So epsilon and mu's per E cell, okay, and usual update equations. Okay. Now, what if my material also has non-zero conductivity? How will my update equations change then? Yeah, there's a lossy thing. So how do I deal with it? Complex permittivity is one thing, but when I do complex permittivity, the implicit assumption there is that I'm going to I expand the fields as in the e to the j omega t form. If I don't want to do that, I want to stay in the time domain. Then how do I deal with introduce a new component? Yeah, how do I introduce it? So this, the let me just write it. So deal with conductivity. First of all, so there is a J term. First of all, this Maxwell's equation, is it complete or there's something missing in it? The J term is missing, right? So what actually is there is that curl of H is equal to dd by dt plus J, and J I can replace by, and that is what law? Ohm's law, right? So Ohm's law right so then this equation will this update equation becomes curl of H is equal to, so let's say epsilon dd by de, sorry, not e, de by dt plus sigma e. Now let's put this into our FDTD notation. Okay. supposing, so I'm going to remove the vector sign, okay, it's understood from by now. So curl of H, supposing I'm updating the electric field at every integer instance, that's what we're doing. So then the magnetic field is updated at half integer, right? So for example, I will write n minus half over here and epsilon E dot at n, right, n minus half, the same time instant, okay, plus sigma E n minus half. I have just written down the whole, I mean the whole equation in discrete form. If the left hand side is at time n minus half, the right hand side should also be at time n minus half. Now this is not a problem because I am implementing this by finite differences. So what does this actually amount to? E n minus E n minus 1 by delta t, right, finite difference in time, and the approximation is most accurate at n minus half, so it's consistent, right? You agree with me so far? So what is the problem now over here? I was storing electric field only at integer time instance, but now this equation is requiring that I also needed at half a time instant. So what should I do? Average it, right? Other, I don't want to be storing electric field at half time integer instance also. So the best thing to do is to replace this term by E n plus E n minus 1 by 2, right? So this is average and this is finite difference, okay, and this is as before. Okay. So this is how you would deal with a material that has conductivity, right? Now in your leapfrog system, what all do you need? So supposing, say you want to update En, what all do you need to know from this equation? I need to know, let's start from the farthest back in time, I need to know En minus 1 and I need Hn minus half, okay. So I can do the my update equations are slightly modified from before just because I have a sigma term has come in over here. Okay. So, that is just some small thing to keep in mind. So, this is your simplistic way of dealing with dielectric materials. Okay. Questions? Okay. Now, what we could do, I mean we can simplify this expression that I have, this update equation, I can simplify this. Typically, I want to update for En. So, I will bring En to one side and everything else to the other side, right. So, I can do that simplification. So for example, what will I get? So try to work it out. So En, I have a En minus 1 and a Hn minus half, right? Those are the two terms over here. So the first term that I get is, I'll just write the final answer, which you, simple manipulation gives it to you. Can confirm that that is also what you get. Okay. So, this is our update equation and just plug in the values of sigma and epsilon. So, remember here in what we have done, your epsilon here is referring only to the real part, okay, and sigma is the conductivity that is giving the loss part.